sound off, we call it J. It's called J. What's the news? What's the info? Talk to me now.
Somewhere in the world this morning, someone's fighting religion or race. But there's only one race and we're human, so let's make this world a better place.
Good afternoon and good evening. This is Carla J and you're watching The Sound Off. We are doing an artist feature today. I'm super excited to have this young lady with us. She is a force to be reckoned with, literally the voice of the millennials. Anonymously known as Image. And, you know, I have to say that with some Image. How are you, Image? Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. I have just taken off like a rocket ship thanks to that introduction.
As you should. You are an absolutely amazing young lady. And
Thank you, Carla.
Behind the scenes, having an opportunity to speak with her, there's a lot that I want to cover today. So I think that we're going to be chopping and screwing this footage for the next few weeks. Like, this is an amazing young lady. Image, if you would, talk to us about yourself. I just want to know the nuts and bolts, the roots and berries of the young lady that makes up this millennial powerhouse, Image.
Myself, who am I? Who are we really? You know, we just had a conversation about that actually, about thoughts and what we create and who we are. I would say that I'm a country singer, songwriter, and my ultimate goal in life is to help bring about world peace through music, country music.
Right. So. Right. And let's go back a little further about, let's talk about your upbringing, because, you know, world peace, love and light, embracing, you know, the positive aspects of our communities and things like that. I want to know a little more about your upbringing. Talk to us, and, you know, of course I know, but you had a model mother.
Yes,
who is,
she
you
was
know,
a model.
Respectfully known as, you know, your momager.
Oh, no! We don't use that term, and I'll tell you why. The funny thing about that is, you know, momager, you have 50-50, mom, manager. Uh-huh. But she always says she's not 50% of anything.
Oh, I love it!
She's 100% a mother, and 100% a manager trying to pass the baton.
Love that.
She wishes she could quit me.
Oh, that's not happening.
Not anytime soon. You know, we work 24/7, and my upbringing was absolutely wonderful. You know, again, I had both of my parents were very creative artists. My father was an actor. His first love is music, and my mother not only was a model, but she was also a songwriter. And so when you have two creative and intelligent minds like that, they want to raise their children in a way where they will be intelligent and creative. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that they encouraged was for us to do anything we wanted to do.
Right.
To pursue whatever creative thing we decided to do that day, whether it be painting or writing or singing or, you know. And so as long as we were doing something positive, they would encourage it.
Exactly.
So it was a beautiful environment. I always call it like a utopia of sorts because we had all of the tools that we wanted. My parents didn't get us the kiddie versions of anything. Everything was adult sized.
Wow.
So if I wanted to, you know, play guitar, my dad would go to, or Guitar Center would send us, you know, an acoustic, a custom Gibson or something like that.
Really?
You know,
full size,
drums, everything. The whole house was always loud. Uh-huh. Always in a creative
mode, right?
Creative mode in the zone.
Yeah, that's right. That's good. And I love that perspective of the momager. That really breaks it down. And I actually look at things a little different, a different perspective now that you've actually said that, you know? And I think that others will too. That's great. And let's talk a little bit about your father. Her father is 90s television icon. Excuse me, let's take that back. 80s television icon. I can go back even further, and I'm kind of throwing my age out there a little bit, but 80s television icon, Philip Michael Thomas, respectfully known as Tubbs from Miami Vice. I mean, he was the originator of the no socks and the
fashion icon.
The no socks and the loafers and the, you know, sleeves rolled up on the blazers and things like that. Mr.
Fast cars.
Yeah.
Fast boats.
Yeah.
Fast women.
Yeah.
My mom was one of those women.
Oh, my.
But she wasn't fast.
Okay. So I'm thinking that she's going to like momager a little more than that comment.
No.
But, I just think that, you know, so as far as him being the fashion icon, I've seen a number of photos of you and, you know, in your social media. It's so fun and it's so creative. Do you think that your parents and your mom being a model, did they have any influence on your sense of style?
Absolutely. I feel like my sense of style for the most part is when I'm off the stage, when I'm not interviewing and stuff like that, is more of a classic, like Audrey Hepburn, just really classic style.
Right.
But my mom is wild when it comes to her. She's a Miami girl, you know? And of course my dad had, you know, the pastels. And
yeah, that's right.
So yeah, huge influence, why not?
Exactly. That's so great. So you're kind of in meeting them somewhere in the middle.
Right. You know, I'm not wearing a thong on Miami Beach like my mom would, but.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, that's what they do as a Miamian, you know.
Yeah, that's
Everyone's
right.
from all over the world, so there's, you know.
Yeah.
Lots of fun.
Exactly. Lots of fun. And then it sounds like
I'm telling everything on this.
No, that's good. I love it. And that's what we're here for. We want to get to know who you are.
Yeah.
You know, who you are as a person. And that's the reason why I start off. You know, you tell me who you are.
Miami mentality. Very relaxed.
Very relaxed. Right. But you also have this, and you know how some would say that flower child vibe about you. Where does that come from? Because, you know, hearing the stories about your mom, and then we see the persona that was your dad.
Yeah.
What was it when you all were at home? Because I'm thinking that probably has some influence on who you are as a person.
Yeah, well, you know, usually people look at the celebrity lifestyle, and, you know, some celebrities go out and they're always at parties and stuff like that, networking and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But I was told by my parents that, you know, they weren't really about the fast party life. Their thing was to contribute to the community when we were younger. They taught us that, you know, it was important to do things that you want to do and to have things, but it was more important to be able to give back. Right. And so we were taught those type of morals of giving back to the community, which in a sense really is giving back to yourself again. Because, you know, like I mentioned on the other interview, is we don't live in a vacuum. Yeah. We live amongst people, and it's important to invest not only in yourself but also in others, so that your whole environment is enriched.
That's right.
So that's what we were taught.
Yeah.
And so if people call it the hippie lifestyle, but really it's a vital way of life.
Exactly.
You know, it's a vital way of not just surviving but thriving.
Exactly. Now talk to us a little more, and we did touch on this subject just a bit earlier. It was a book that you said that had a huge influence on the way that you just kind of went about your day to day.
So there's a lot of different books that I enjoy. One of them, one of the people is Jiddu Krishnamurti. He's, for those who aren't familiar, he's kind of like an Eckhart Tolle type, conversations with God, Dr. Wayne Dyer. Those are my influences. I really enjoy the message. It's a very simple message that speaks to what's already in us, in our hearts, and that just we just need to be reminded of. I guess you would say. You know, we talked about being millennials earlier and how the separation gap between us as a human race is narrowing and narrowing with each generation. We see ourselves in one another.
Right.
We don't see another person and say, okay, well, that's the other. We see each other in that other person as well. And I think it's really important that.
Right.
So.
Right. And then there was another minimalist.
Oh, the minimalist.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
So on my drive here to Houston, I watched the documentary that actually came out last night called the Minimalist, and it's basically all about downsizing to only the things that you absolutely love, and not being subjected to this of overconsumption. You know, America is a society of overexposure and consuming more than we need to. We have the average household apparently has 300,000 items, and most of those things we just don't need. And so one of the things they talk about is, you know, donating things that you don't need, or, you know, selling them in a garage sale. And you tend to be a lot happier when you can wake up in the morning and you look in your closet and, you know, you have everything in your closet is something that you absolutely love. It's not something like that's been in the corner for 2 years.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, why not give whatever you haven't worn for 2 years to someone who could actually cherish it? You know, so it's giving everything its place.
That's right.
And it seeps into your mindset, too.
I love that. Love that. And see, what did I say, you guys, at the top of the show, at the top of this interview, that, you know, truly the voice of the millennial, truly inspirational. And to be so young, I absolutely love it. Okay, so I would like to know, country music, where did that come from? And as a young lady, and you gave us a bit of background about your family and, you know, just this just open kind of do what you will vibe, as long as you're doing something that's constructive and positive.
Yeah.
What made you segue into country music as opposed to pop music or, you know, because I mean, and again, I'm just kind of attributing that to your youth. But, and that's the in thing now.
Yeah.
Why country music?
Well, there's something about country that I've always loved. It's not something you can necessarily explain. Mm-hmm. It's just my love for the way it sounds, the organic vibe of it, mm-hmm. being on a back porch, strumming a guitar.
Yeah.
You know, I love traditional country more than anything. That's what really solidified my love of country music. Mm-hmm. I'm also a songwriter, and in country music, songwriting is very well respected.
Yes.
People know the songwriters in Nashville, you know the names, and people love the songwriters. And I've just always loved it. My mom grew up listening to country music, Linda Ronstadt, Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
And, you know, my grandma would be like, let her play her country music, when her siblings was like, turn that racket down.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm sure, unbeknownst to me, it filtered in that way.
Yeah.
Of course, you could walk into our house and hear anything, mm-hmm. from classical to Bob Dylan, John Lennon, to Johnny Cash. And again, I gravitated to country. I just love it.
Oh, that's great. And so what are some of, or who are some of your early influences?
Johnny Cash is a huge influence.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we sing about the same things. You know, he talks about being the man in black,
yeah.
and how he wouldn't wear any other color until the world changed.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, he talks about, you know, people say, do what Jesus does, and then they go off and do something completely different.
Mm-hmm.
Or what would Jesus do, or whatever.
Yeah.
And he talks about that in his song. And Johnny Cash, I also love Willie Nelson, Loretta Lynn, Charlie Prine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's a black country artist.
Absolutely.
And
yeah.
I met him, and he's incredible. He does the best collage I've ever heard in my life.
Really?
If you've never heard collage, the first one you need to listen to is Charlie Prine. Hank Williams Sr. is the one who wrote it, but Charlie, amazing version of the song.
So what are some nuggets? What are some tidbits of information that Charlie Pride gave you during y'all's conversation or your interaction?
It's one of those things where, you know, it's pretty much the same thing that every celebrity tells you. Well, not every celebrity, but my parents have told me, which is to follow your passion and to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't let anything stop you from pursuing your dreams. If you're passionate about it, and if it's something that is going to add to the consciousness,
mm-hmm.
to lift the consciousness of the world, then more power to you.
Wonderful.
So.
Wonderful. Okay, so did you all speak about any of the direction of your writing by chance? And the reason why I ask that is because, being that he's an African-American country singer,
mm-hmm.
your writing is
bold.
A lot of your writing, you speak about race issues.
Yeah.
You speak about social issues.
Absolutely.
You speak about injustices.
Yeah.
Was that a conversation
No.
you all had? And what made you take the turn and go into those bold directions in reference to your writing and your music?
Art reflects what's going on in society.
Mm-hmm.
You know, And I don't avoid that. That's something that I go deep into because I think it's important that if someone's listening to a song, you know, songs are going to program you anyway. You can listen to a song on a radio and hate it the first time you hear it, but you're going to hear that song about 100,000 times.
That's right.
That's a lot. You're going to hear that song, you're going to love it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just, it ends up happening. Have that happened to you before?
That's happened. In fact, we spoke right. about that. I can't, the song shall remain nameless, but we spoke about that on the show a couple of weeks ago, and one of the co-hosts was saying, I can't
this
stand
this song.
This
is so stupid.
Yeah, I hate this song. But then I saw his social media. He's posting quotes from that song just a couple of days ago. And
you're humming it. You're like, why am I humming this song?
I just commented on it, and I said, gotcha. You know, because I knew it. I knew it. I told him, you know what, just let it just resonate with you. Let it, you know, after you hear it. And he's like, no, it's not going to happen. I said, yes, it is.
Right. So yeah. To that point, I feel like it's important for me to take responsibility and that my song has something of substance that speaks to what's going on mm-hmm. and that speaks to the hearts of people. So that's why I do speak about, you know, Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King in different kind of country. Because I talk about being a different kind of country, which, you know, I get that interview question a lot mm-hmm. about being an African-American country singer. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of a double entendre in that you're talking about being a quote-unquote different kind of country at face value, but also about what I sing about. I sing about peace and love, and I sing about society. When we talk about Colorblind, the song Colorblind,
love it.
You know, when we usually talk about, when someone usually says, oh, I'm colorblind, it's like, it's like a hit to the chest, like, wait a minute, you don't see me? Mm-hmm. You know, but I wanted to take that term and kind of reel in the people who use that term as a way of, you know, they feel like using that term is a way to bring them closer to someone that's different yeah. from themselves. Mm-hmm. And I wanted them to hear it and listen and understand that the new perception of quote unquote colorblind isn't about ignoring color or saying I don't see color because you obviously see color, right. but it's to say that you see people for who they actually are. You want to get to know them for who they actually are
right.
instead of ignoring mm-hmm. the color. And we use the word color as a metaphor for everything that is humankind, whether it's the most obvious one, the color of your skin, whether it's right. a different religion, different mm-hmm. genders, different, you know, ways you go about the world.
Yeah.
Color is what creates our world.
That's true.
So and without it, it'd be such a dull place if we were all the same, you know?
Yeah. That's true. That's so true. I love that. I love that analogy. I love that song.
Thank
so
you.
So those of you that haven't heard it, you have to go and listen to Colorblind. And you can download that on pretty much every medium that's out there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
iTunes,
it's definitely
everything.
Available. Have you had any obstacles mm-hmm. being that these are some of the topics that you write about, being that you are an African-American young lady singing country music?
Hmm.
I ask because of the obvious, Beyoncé performing with the Dixie Chicks.
Yeah,
at the Country Music
I loved
Awards.
It, to be honest.
I absolutely loved,
I loved it,
but there were a lot of folks that didn't, and so much so that it had a huge impact, and they wiped it from the website. They wiped it
yeah.
from all things on the internet.
Yeah.
Have you experienced any of those obstacles, any of those, you know, that's a huge injustice, if you will,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah, I haven't experienced anything like that. I think more so because if I was singing country in a country show, people wouldn't be as insane about it. Mm-hmm. But the whole fact that they wiped her out and that what they were talking about online, I thought was, you know, pretty ridiculous. I think she did an amazing job.
I did,
too. To be completely honest. And plus, they've had people like Justin Timberlake. Didn't they have Justin Timberlake
they
on the show?
They had Justin Timberlake last year.
They've had Jamie Foxx, I believe, was on the show.
That was a few years, about 3-4. Well, you see, I'm going to, I love it,
but
it was, I love Carrie Underwood. I love
I think it was, yeah.
that was like 3-4 years ago. Jamie Foxx was,
yeah. So, but I think it was huge with, I think there was a massive issue with Beyonce because of the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. You know, when she did the Super Bowl, that was hugely controversial because it was so pro-black.
Yeah.
So, but people, a lot of people don't understand that pro-black isn't anti-everyone else.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for the longest time, we have been kept under. We are a minority. Mm-hmm. And we've been taught not to love ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And so for you to say I'm proud of being Black is a beautiful thing. It's something that reverses the destruction that has been going on for so many years that a lot of people, you know, just don't understand outside of the community. Mm-hmm. So it's not a negative thing, and I wish people would understand that more. And that's another thing that I hope to, in the future, be able to get people to understand the different perspectives of people in different cultures. Mm-hmm. Because something that may not affect you is actually affecting someone else. And it's important to be open to understanding somebody else's perception as they walk through life. Mm-hmm. So, and that was just that whole situation. So no, I haven't experienced anything like that, but you know, you do have some people that are negative towards the fact that I'm different, Black country singer, or that I sing about certain things, but that, it's so few and far between that it's actually not something I actually even pay attention to until I'm asked a question, like I've just been asked. Mm-hmm. That's not something that is a daily occurrence, or, you know, maybe a couple of times a year, if that.
Really?
So, yeah, and I think it's because of the way our society is changing in different kind of country. I talk about how we are becoming, whether you like it or not, we are becoming a different kind of country.
Right.
You know, the millennials are ushering so many different beautiful things that we are changing. The only constant is change. That's science.
That's true. That's definitely a fact, for
sure.
Darius Rucker, what are your thoughts about him as an artist?
He's cool. I met him at, where were we, at CRS. We met him. I like him. He's really cool.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that someone, has he heard you sing? Do you know? Was it a situation where you performed or anything?
No, it wasn't a situation. It was just artists meeting artists.
Really?
He may have. I feel like a lot, you know, it's funny, a lot of people have heard of me without me knowing that they've heard of me. So, and that's a cool thing too.
Very cool.
So maybe, I don't know.
You're amazing. Absolutely amazing. Talk to me about your journey in the industry. And, you know, I know that your mother is like a force in your backbone, and she's, you know, right there. So I mean, you know, in every sense of the word, like, she's right there to catch you if you are, you know, if you ever fall. And I'm sure that it's been difficult, you know, with some of the things that you all have gone through together. Talk to us about, you know, the journey thus far when you decided, you know what, Mom, I want to get into this industry.
Yeah, she
talked to us about that first conversation and the lead up to now. And because this is going to be something that's going to be impactful to a lot of those young people and a lot of those parents out there, where they need to step out on faith and trust and believe in their child.
It is faith.
And
it's absolutely.
Talk to us about that journey.
So her instant reaction was like Kevin Hart, no. I wasn't ready. She's like, no. She's like, are you sure? Because I did so well in school. Mm-hmm. You know, I was a straight A student. And she's like, don't you want to be like a doctor or a lawyer or something like that? You know, I don't want you in this industry. It's a difficult industry. People are, you know, evil. No.
Yeah.
Well,
people,
sometimes.
People can be rough.
She did not want me in this industry at all. Mm-hmm. At all. I was dragging her. And, you know, she moved out of Miami to get out from under being Philip Michael Thomas's wife, you know, even though they love each other. But she didn't want to be known as.
Just in that shadow.
In the shadow. She wanted to come to Texas. She always says, marry a farmer. But I ended up dragging her right back in, and she didn't marry a farmer, but we, you know, go to a lot of farms now and go through a lot of farms.
Okay, yeah, a lot of farm towns.
Middle America.
Yeah.
The journey has been wonderful, and, you know, we spent like over a year on tour, going to different country radio stations, some in the middle of nowhere, some in, you know, metropolitan areas, and it's been her, myself, and Uncle Kevin, who's filming. And
shout out to Uncle Kevin.
Shout out to Uncle Kev. And it's just been a beautiful journey, and meeting all the different DJs and, you know, on the road. And I've come to realize that people actually do listen to lyrics, and which is a wonderful thing for a songwriter. So the journey has been wonderful. There really hasn't been many bumps in the road. It's just about, you know, keeping that engine going, or the little engine. We're really, we call ourselves the little engine that could, and just keep chucking away, chucking over the mountain. You remember that movie?
Oh, yeah, I definitely do. That was a story. That was a bedtime story before it was a movie.
Yes, and I love a song in that. It brings back a flood of childhood memories. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're going up that mountain, and we're getting to the light, and we're not only are we going up to the top of the mountain, but we're bringing gifts to the world.
Yes.
I'm so corny.
You are that gift. No.
But that's
not corny. That's legitimate. That's true.
But that's what we feel. And, you know, I don't feel like I'm the only person. I feel like there's millions of us out there who have our own journeys. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's not as broad and overreaching as becoming a country singer in the music industry, but we all have our little journeys where we're bringing something to the world, and I'm just one of millions who wants to do that.
Right.
So,
do you ever get discouraged? Do you ever get just kind of bummed out and like, you know what?
I'm never discouraged ever.
Just
me and the robot. No, I mean, there are times when you get discouraged, but it's not something, you know, Paris and I were talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. You know, you have fleeting thoughts, and it's not something that you latch onto. And that's what, you know, the difference between someone who makes it in the industry and someone, quote unquote, makes it. To me, if you're an artist doing what you love, you've already made it.
Yes.
You know, but the difference between someone who reads the quote unquote, the pinnacle, or whatever you want to call it, and someone who doesn't, is persistence.
Yes.
That's it. Mm-hmm. All it is persistence. And it's also who you know.
Yeah.
That's a massive part of it, too, because it is really like a lottery.
That's true.
It really is. And it's all about who you know. But my whole thing, my love is to be able to go out there and to perform and for people to feel something, something that you can't really name, but something spiritual that kind of connects us. I always say that I want to have a monologue when I perform. Not a monologue. I want to have a dialogue when I perform. Mm-hmm. I don't want it to be a monologue where I'm just like, hey, you know, here we are. You know, I want people to get something from it, even if we don't necessarily speak, or even if we don't necessarily have the meet and greet before the show. I want everyone to be able to have that kind of spiritual dialogue, regardless of what you believe in, something that it makes you feel something. We're both feeling something.
That is true. So. That is true. How important is it for you to impact other people?
Oh, that's at the top of the list.
Yeah.
It's the number one thing.
Yeah.
Otherwise, there's no point.
Exactly.
Because I'm, you know, singing in a ball, snow globe.
Okay.
It's the number one thing.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's true. How many languages? I understand that you sing in you're multilingual.
Yeah.
You're multilingual.
Well, I taught myself to sing phonetically. I always call music the universal language. It is, other than math. You know, math can reach outer space and everything.
Yeah.
But other than that, music is a universal language because it can touch you without you even knowing what they're singing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the stupid song that you don't like, and then a week later you're like,
Yeah, that's where it come from. Yeah,
it's the universal language.
That's true.
So I've always loved to sing. So if I heard a song in a different language, let's say in Japanese, and I wanted to sing the song, then I'd sing the song.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it was really that simple.
Awesome.
But my father actually, he did a lot of work in different languages, in Italian, I believe in French, German. He's always speaking to me in those languages. You know, sometimes I'm like, you know. And maybe I get it from him in that regard, and being able to pick up languages so quickly. But I sing in, English, of course.
Mm-hmm.
German, Italian, French, Japanese. I was learning some Russian.
Really?
I love Russian.
Oh my goodness. I
love it though. Don't you love that? No.
Maybe if you're just in one of those moods where you just want to be just hard, Russian is just like you know.
And you know that's our perspective. As English speakers, we see it differently.
Yeah.
But you know, I learned little things like Mir Ilubov and Strasvutie, Koktela. you know, privet.
See, when you say it, it sounds smooth. It sounds
I smooth okay. it out.
Yeah, but when you hear, you know, I mean, well, to me, when I've heard someone speaking Russian, it's, you know, it's like you have to be, you know, you have to say it from your throat. You know, Kevin Hart, say it from your chest.
Yeah.
You know?
Russian so, and German is like
yeah, German too. Yeah.
Japanese
yeah.
a little bit is a little like that, but
Japanese is hyper.
I love Russian though.
Really?
And I really want to learn more. I only know a little bit because I was supposed to go to Russia. Mm-hmm. But the whole issue with a lot of things going on there.
Yeah.
but so yeah, and I have a new language that I learned, but that will be revealed. Actually, will this be out by the time I've done that, probably? Done the show?
No, probably not, no.
No, okay. Then never mind, I won't say.
Yeah, you can't say right now. This will be out probably in a couple of days.
Oh, in a couple of days. Well, it'll be done by then. My new language that I'm singing in is Chinese.
Get out of here.
Mandarin. Yeah.
No way.
Now, you think Russian is... No. I put it this way, and I really want to learn the language, mm-hmm. but it's difficult to learn. I think even for native speakers, because I've come in contact with a lot of people who speak Cantonese, but not, you know, the Mandarin. It's kind of like learning, like if you put Russian and German and Japanese all together.
Really?
That was just
That's busy. That's
that
busy
was my experience teaching myself. I was like, what?
No way.
But so, once you.
All of those additional languages are all self-taught.
It's like, well, I, yeah.
That's so
if I, what I do is I listen to someone speak it mm-hmm. or sing it.
Right.
It helps more if somebody's singing it because then I can understand it better. Because when you sing it, it's kind of streamlines it into curves. Mm-hmm. For me, you know, you sing something, you memorize it better.
That's right.
But for me, that was my experience trying to teach myself how to speak the language,
wow.
sing the language,
mm-hmm.
but once you learn it, once you learn a language, it's so fulfilling, because it just kind of flows.
That's right. So you are truly gifted. You're like one of those people that they say that some people can actually see, you know, words, and they can
see the colors.
Yeah, the colors.
When you hear something.
And the wave, you know, the waves of sound and, you know, different things like that. You are a truly gifted young lady. I'm really impressed with you. I'm really impressed. And I think that you're going to be a huge influence and a huge impact. So I understand where your mom was coming from, you know, and especially with the great grades that you had in school.
Yeah.
You know, why wouldn't you be a doctor? Why wouldn't you be a, you know, engineer, a scientist, or whatever the case may be. But one of the things that I'm coming to see and just listening to you and the things that you aspire to do and accomplish in this world is you're going to touch so many more people and mm-hmm. have such an impact and an influence on so many people's lives. And
Thank
that's
you.
Why I say truly the voice of the millennium and making a difference and making a change. Like, this is amazing. This is a big deal. This is a big deal, people. Like, yeah, this is truly a big deal. You've been touring and you went on the world tour. Nailed it. on the world tour. And, you know, talk to us about some of the artists that you've come in contact with, that you've been writing with. And I know that one in particular that I love that has a backstory herself and has come to influence a lot of people, that's someone that's impacted you. Talk to me about that. I think you know what I'm talking about.
You're talking about Leanne.
Yes.
Leanne Rimes.
Yes, I am.
You know, it's
Miss Rimes.
It's so interesting because whenever we were on tour for all that time, everywhere we went, people would be like, you know who you remind me of Leanne Rimes.
Mm-hmm.
That's before I sang.
Wow.
So something, yeah. And also, you know, my dearest friend, Ron Grimes, who is just an angel in my life as far as music is concerned, and he's just got a heart of gold. And, he was another one who said I reminded him of Leanne, the way we look, I guess. It's something about the mannerisms or the way we look or something. And I love her.
Yeah.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
That's it. That's it.
But I love her. You know, she started very young. I could have started younger, but my mom postponed as long as she could.
Mm-hmm.
Again, she didn't want me to be in the industry.
Yeah, the industry. Yeah.
But, and she was what they call... Oh, I don't know the English term, Wunderkind. the English word for that is?
I have no idea.
You know, someone who's huge, one that, prodigy.
Prodigy, yeah, there you go. Okay, you're like saying another language. Like, okay, what is that?
Yeah, I think that's English too, though. Wunderkind. But I think in German it's Wunderkind.
Okay.
Anyway, okay. I could be saying it wrong because I have so many languages in my head.
But you said it in German as if I was going to know what that meant.
So she started very young, you know, when she was 12, I think, and that's when Ron knew her. Mm-hmm. And the funniest thing is, you know, he wanted a song that would impact the world. He wanted to put out a song or music that would impact the world as well. Mm-hmm. And who knew it would take a 12-year-old, you know, to shoot him out into the stars and to impact so many people. And, you know, he's a multi-platinum songwriter. Yeah. Most known for his work with Leanne. Mm-hmm. We've written so many songs together, and I just went into the studio with him a couple of days ago after quickly learning this song, and that I will perform tomorrow for the kids. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to hug the kids, the little
kiddos.
That's
so cool.
So he's been incredible in my life, and we actually went to Colorado, and I opened. Well, they called me a special guest of Leanne Rimes and Colin Ray. And so they were reunited there. Mm-hmm. And she's just incredible. I love her.
Wow.
Everything about her, her voice, you know, she's so classy.
Yeah.
And she's so intelligent, such a gift with that voice.
Oh, well, look who's talking. But see, that's what, and you mentioned people saying that you remind them of Leanne Rimes, and you don't know what it is, and this is before you even open your mouth and sing. What I think it is, and we spoke about this and we touched on it earlier, is the millennials are the generation of energy.
Ah, yes.
And you all exude this positive energy, and it's a light, and how you can see the reflection of yourself and others through that energy.
Yeah.
There you go.
There it is.
You know, so there it is. There it is. Voila. You know, I just think that that's what it is. And I mean, that's a true thing. There is a true, and I'm a true believer in the transference of positive and negative energy and seeing a reflection of yourself and others. And I think that that's what it is. And think about the impact that you all have on people, that people can see that.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. That people can see that. So that speaks a lot about each of you all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that really does. So, you know, kudos to you and Leanne. And I'm just just excited to see what the future brings for you. And speaking of which, talk to us about any of the projects. What do you have up and coming, and any tour stops that any of your fans can come and check you out?
Yeah, so, you know, 2016 is coming to a close. 2017, we have some major surprises. I really wish I could mention them right now, but I can't. So go to facebook.com/ImageOfficial, I-M-A-J official, and I will be announcing some surprises.
Oh, lovely.
We always, I'm going to be going on a radio tour, of course, for the next single, which will be announced shortly as well.
Okay.
So, and I can't wait to go on tour. It's my favorite part, to go and meet everyone.
Because you can touch the people. You
can
get out there and you can impact lives and impact people.
And I can meet people and they can impact me. You know, one of my biggest goals is to go on a world tour and to be able to learn from different cultures and different people.
Yeah.
And to me, that's so important.
Yeah.
To be able to immerse yourself into cultures that are different from your own, because then you become more of a well-rounded, balanced person, and you're able to make decisions that not only benefit yourself but benefit the world.
Right. And so. you aspire to do things and benefit the world, and you spoke about social issues and things like that, and you're really patriotic, you know, America's sweetheart. Have you had an opportunity to perform for the troops? Or
You know what I did with Colin Ray? I'm trying to think, what else did I do? Do you remember? I went blank. But we have some things coming up for the troops.
Mm-hmm.
I did put out a single called His Story, Her Story, specifically written for our men and women in uniform.
Oh,
it mentions the women.
Mm-hmm.
Very goes in depth about women.
Mm-hmm.
So that's for the troops. And I do plan on performing more for the military in the future.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
That's good. That's great.
Because they make so, they, their sacrifices are so great.
That's true.
Their courage is so incredible. Actually, you know, I just wrote a, you can write to the soldiers. Well, not only to soldiers, but also to people who, to people who are active duty, but also to veterans, mm-hmm. to new recruits. Mm-hmm. And they say one of the things that they treasure the most are the letters that they get from people around, you know, the country.
That's true.
So I wrote them a letter and sent them some music. And
I
hope that, you know, it does something.
Of course it will. That's great. And speaking of which, what are, you know, and from a millennial perspective, what is it that we can do as a society to bring peace and love and solidarity to our America?
One of the biggest things that you can do is actually, one of the main things you can do is a cliche, and it's a cliche for a reason. Mm-hmm. And that's to put yourself in someone else's moccasins. Because if we continually are one-sided, hence for what it's worth, the song, you know, we're all holding up our own signs, then you're going to constantly be in conflict because you say this and you say that and we never meet in the middle. So it's important to, you know, be passionate about what you believe in, but also to delve into the facts of what other people are talking about. Even if you completely can't stand them, look to see if there's any fact in what they're saying. And then also see how things you do can holistically impact people. It's important not to be so self-involved.
Right.
Because, you know, we have the selfies.
Oh, yeah. self-involved.
First, let me take a selfie.
Literally. Yeah.
You know, and that's cool. But also keep in mind that you live in an environment. And it's an environment that consists of more than just myself as the center of the universe, which we are not, believe it or not.
Yeah, that's true.
We aren't the center. We live in the boondocks of our own galaxy. So
that's why I said our America,
you know?
Because and it's going to be you millennials that, you know, have that impact on our country. I think it's going to be your generation that's going to make that difference and make that change.
Making an informed decision. That's really the heart of the matter, is to be informed before you make a decision.
Love that. Make informed decisions. That's right. Before you make an assumption, prejudge someone, judge a book by its cover, you know, any of that. Get to know someone.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm guilty of that. I've done that a time or two.
And we've all done it.
Yeah.
And the beautiful thing about having done it and even doing it is being able to catch yourself in the moment.
Yeah.
Or even after the moment. As long as you learn from whatever experience that you've had, I mean, there's, you know, we're humans.
Yeah.
We're going to do things that we don't necessarily believe in. We might make a mistake and do something completely opposite of what we actually believe in. Mm-hmm. But if we're able to reflect on that and say, you know what, that wasn't cool. I'm going to change that. That's how you change the world. It's not about being perfect.
That's right.
It's far from being perfect. It's being able to reassess, or it's being able to look at your life, to observe it from afar.
Oh, love that. Like, step out of
body experience.
Yeah, have that out of body experience. Step out of your shoes and, you know, just kind of look at it from someone else's perspective other than yours. I love that. Love that. Love this young lady, Imaj. love her. Talk to the public, Imaj, if you will. And I know that you gave them Facebook information, if you would. So again, I know you have an amazing website that's out. And all of your social media, talk to the public and,
awesome.
And let them know how they can stay in contact with all things Imaj.
So you guys can stay in contact with me at loveimaj.com. On Facebook, facebook.com/ImajOfficial. IMAJ Official, or you can just look up IMAJ Imaj. I've got a little blue check mark. if you're on Instagram, which a lot of people are, at Imaj, IMAJ, and if you're still on Twitter, at Love Imaj, LOVE Imaj.
All right, that is wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us. And there's just so much that, if an expectation was set today, ever was set, it was definitely one set today. Because I expect great things from you.
Oh,
I
wonderful.
Really do. I really do. whether it's the music, whether it's, you know, you getting out there in public speaking and doing all things with various foundations and causes throughout our country.
I'd love that.
I definitely see that and I expect that. And I really appreciate you.
Thank
I really
you. Do. I appreciate you.
Thank you so much, Amash, for joining us. And you guys, thank you so much for watching The Sound Off. Love you. Good night.
Peace and love.
Peace and love.
Sound off with Connor J. It's Connor J.